Hello, everyone, and welcome to February's installment of Pacific Neuroscience Institute in conjunction with Providence, Southern California's Neuroscience Grand Rounds. We're so excited for today's talk. I've actually been badgering Dr. Diaz for several months now to do this talk, and we've been trying to find the perfect time for it. And I think this is a great period to present this at the start of the new year. Dr. Natalie Diaz is a board-certified neurologist with fellowship training in movement disorders. Her clinical practice focuses on the evaluation and management of patients with Parkinson's disease, Parkinsonian disorders, Huntington's disease, and other choriform disorders, including otherwise also dystonia and ataxia. She also has specialized training in the evaluation and programming of deep brain stimulation as a treatment for Parkinson's disease, essential tremor, and dystonia, as well as a therapeutic administration for botulinum toxin injections for non-cosmetic indications such as focal dystonia, hemifacial spasm, and limb spasticity. Her research focuses on industry-sponsored clinical trials in Parkinson's disease and other collaborative clinical projects in the field of neurodegenerative disorders. She is right down here at Pacific Neuroscience Institute South Bay and Providence Little Company of Mary in Torrance, and she's been a wonderful addition to our group, and I have the pleasure of working with her on a day-to-day basis, so I'm so excited. Dr. Diaz will be taking over my screen here as I back out. So with that, Dr. Diaz, the floor is yours, and thank you so much. Is that showing up okay, Elizabeth?
No, there's actually nothing up yet.
Okay. Let me try another way to do this. That should be better.
Yeah, can you go to the one slide? Yeah, there we go. Looks good.
Wait, is that still good there?
Yes, it looks great.
Perfect.
Dr. Diaz. All right. Thank you, Dr. Sivakumar. And I apologize, everybody. Good afternoon for that delay. I included some videos in my presentation, and as always, I had some issues with getting them up and running, but I think we've covered the glitches and I've hijacked Dr. Sivakumar's office. So welcome everybody. And as Wally said, I'm a movement disorder neurologist and I joined Pacific Neuroscience in 2019. I took over for my colleague, Melita Petrosian, who used to be here before that doing specialized clinic once a month. So I'm going to be talking today kind of like a general overview of what we have available currently in terms of medical and surgical therapies for two of the most common movement disorders we see in our clinic, essential tremor and Parkinson's disease. So in addition to being a clinician, I've also done industry-sponsored clinical trials in both of these conditions over the last decade, a little bit more than a decade, with one last one being here at PNI for essential tremor, but I have no disclosures at this time. So at the end of this activity, what I hope is that people will understand how our incidence and prevalence of these two disorders and neurodegenerative diseases in general is increasing exponentially, and the burden that they will have on our society, as well as which groups of people are most at risk for developing these conditions, a little bit about an overview of the clinical recognition of these two conditions, what therapies do we have available in terms of medications, what their potential complications and limitations are, as well as some of the surgical therapies that are available and who is a good candidate for them. So when I started this clinic in 2019, or when I joined and took over for Melita Petrosian, I came from doing a mixture of general neurology and subspecialty neurology and movement disorders. And all my colleagues said to me, there's no way you're going to be able to do a full service movement disorder clinic in private practice outside of an academic institution. You're just not going to have enough business. And here we are, you know, nearly 5 years later, and I can tell you, not only am I busy, but I've got a waiting list, as a lot of people who know me and work with us know. And as I talk to my colleagues across the country, that's not just me. It is a growing trend throughout the country. The movement disorder centers are being inundated with, you know, Parkinson's disease, essential tremor, and some other forms of Parkinson's. And there are studies that have shown that there is a rising tide of degenerative disease, including now movement disorders. You know, we used to talk about the pandemic of Alzheimer's that was, you know, going to hit us. But now we know that movement disorders are also rising exponentially. Dementia with Lewy bodies, Parkinson's disease, and essential tremor are, you know, some of the top four movement disorders that are growing significantly. And as conditions that are chronic, span decades, affect mobility, affect cognitive, affect disability, affect caregivers, this is a growing burden on our healthcare system. And we see rising costs throughout the nation, both for direct and indirect costs. So let's focus a little bit on each one of these. So for essential tremor, the World Health Organization, as well as the International Tremor Organization, estimate that about 10 million people in this country suffer with essential tremor. And it's estimated that about 1% of the global population, which at my last estimates that I read are 8 billion people. And we think that this is low because a lot of people that have tremor, if it doesn't get in their way, don't seek medical attention. And people with tremor that have strong family histories sometimes know that, you know, our therapies are moderated best and maybe don't seek. So we think that these are low numbers. And the incidence and prevalence increases with age, so that by the time people are in their 70s and 80s, there's about a 20% risk of developing essential tremor. It's roughly split between men and female, although some studies have shown a predominance in one sex or other, but it generally we think it's pretty equal split. We don't have a lot of great data about ethnicity and race in essential tremor, unfortunately. We do know that there tends to be a bimodal incidence, so that there's a peak around 20 or 30. These tend to be people that have more of a genetic pure form of essential tremor. But then there's another late peak around the age of 60s and 70s. And these people usually don't have a strong family history, or if they do, tend to have a more complicated form of essential tremor. But essential tremor can present at any age. I've even diagnosed it at 90. It is still mainly a clinical diagnosis. We have a postural and kinetic tremor of the upper extremities in the beginning, does not affect daily activities, but as you know, time progresses, the amplitude of that tremor can increase. And it can affect all sorts of daily activities, from writing to holding eating utensils to holding drinking, holding a phone, working on their computer, doing their work. We need upper extremity tremor to make the diagnosis, but about 30% of people can have a head tremor, 20% can have a voice tremor, about 10% of people can have a leg tremor, and 5% of people can have facial muscle tremor. Head tremor can occur in the in a static position, many times with underlying dystonia, but voice, leg, and face are usually action tremors. When people go to use the muscles, they occur. And usually to make this diagnosis, we need to exclude secondary causes. They don't have Parkinson's, there's no thyroid disease, there's no significant liver or kidney disease, they're not on medications that can promote tremor. There is an anxiety that's part of it. So we usually have to exclude all sorts of other things that can bring on tremor before we can make that diagnosis. Many times diagnosis is delayed. Like I said, if they don't, you know, have any interference in their daily activities, they may not seek medical attention. It can also be misdiagnosed in about 25% of cases. And we now know that there's a new entity called ET plus syndrome, usually tends to be of older onset. These patients can have spillover of tremor into rest tremor. They can have underlying dystonias in the neck and the hand. They can have gait abnormalities, mainly ataxic-like gait And they can even have non-motor symptoms like cognitive decline and psychiatric issues. These are progressive conditions in most people that lead to progressive disability, loss of independence, and decreased quality of life. Unfortunately, our management of essential tremor is still probably similar to what we all learned in medical school. We have four main classes of medications we use. There's first-line agents such as propranolol and primidone. Propranolol being the only drug that's actually approved for essential tremor, works mostly in the periphery, in the muscles, whereas primidone is a central GABAergic, GABA-A enhancer. Both of them have been shown to be equally effective, and which one we choose depends on the patient's age, depends on their other comorbid issues. Primidone, we have to be careful with because it is an inducer of several CYP enzymes. So if people are on blood thinners and other medications, sometimes the levels can get affected. And we generally don't use primidone if people are on blood thinners. If people can't tolerate those or they're ineffective, then we move to second line agents, gabapentinoids such as gabapentin, pregabalin, topiramate, or zonisamide. These are all GABA enhancers, GABA-A enhancers, gabapentin actually increasing GABAergic tone in the central nervous system. We can use non-selective beta blockers such as atenolol and metoprolol. And then if all else fails, although we generally try not to resort to this, sometimes we'll use benzodiazepines. But even with that, only about 30 to 50% of patients can get a significant reduction of their tremor. And at the best, our goal is if people have moderate to severe tremor, then we'll reduce it by 50%. And this has been reproduced in studies. Now, if patients have a mild degree of tremor, this may be useful. But in many patients, it's just not enough. We always have a conversation, or I may send patients to occupational therapy. There's a variety of utensils and other aids that are available, from heavy-weighted, large-bore writing utensils and eating utensils, heavy-weighted, heavy-bottom cups that have a lid, vibrating utensils. There are orthotics that have weights inside them to help weight down the tremor. And I usually refer people to the Essential Tremor Organization that has a nice listing of all the different orthotics that are out there. There's also something that's called the Calitrio device that's been approved since 2018. It's a wrist-worn neuromodulary device that gives alternating stimulation to the median nerve as well as the radial nerve at the wrist. It's meant to promote signals up to the ventral intermedius of the thalamus, which is where we do DBS and other surgical things. And it's been shown to temporarily reduce tremor by about 50% in people that have moderate to severe tremor. It's a transient effect, so it only lasts about an hour or two, but people can use it multiple times a day. Occasionally, they can have a little bit of burning or tingling associated with it. But it's good, as I always sell it to patients, you know, if you can get an hour or two in the morning, an hour or two in the afternoon to allow you to eat, do your checks, or if you're going out and socializing with friends, it may be a good thing to use in those sort of moments to bring back a little bit of independence and functional use. One of the reasons we don't have great medications for essential tremor is we just still don't understand it after many years. We used to think it was a very strong genetic component, but finding genetic mutations has been very elusive. We also think that there's probably a strong neurodegenerative component to this condition. And what we've seen thus far is Purkinje cells seem to degenerate. There's loss of dendritic spines and simplification of the dendrites in Purkinje cells in this disorder, which we think probably decreases GABAergic tone to the deep cerebellar nuclei and unleashes a rhythmicity of cells from, you know, the thalamocortical pathways. And so what we think this is there's the propagation of not just one isolatory area in the brain, but probably multiple, as the GABAergic tone is decreased in the brain, which is why a lot of the GABAergic medications work. Looking into the pipeline, there's a couple of things that look very interesting. They're looking at T-type calcium channel blockers. These are low voltage calcium receptors that tend to kind of be under GABAergic inhibition. And once that inhibition is lifted, they start to have multiple, you know, oscillatory rhythmicity. And if you entrain enough cells together in animal models, they've been able to produce something that looks like essential tremor. So this is currently being studied right now. They're also looking at GABA-A positive allosteric modulators. So, you know, we have a lot of GABA-A medications that are currently available, but they're non-selective for all the different subunits in the GABA-A receptor, which is why a lot of people experience cognitive and side effects and sedation. These are tend to be more specific to the tremor reducing areas of the or subunits of that receptor. So I'm going to take a little pivot, and now I'm going to talk about Parkinson's disease. So this is a condition that's much less common than essential tremor. It's estimated that there's about 1 million people in this country with Parkinson's, about 10 million people worldwide. The Parkinson's Foundation estimates that there's about 90,000 new cases every year that are being diagnosed. It tends to increase with age, so age being one of the most highest risk factors associated with condition. Starting at around the 50 to 60 age group, we really see both the incidence and the prevalence of this condition kind of take off. And then if you get to about 85 or 90, the incidence tends to drop off. So, you know, definitely there's an exponential increase from, you know, 1% at around 5 to 50 to 60 to about 5% in risk at age 80. It generally is split men and female, although multiple studies have shown that there's a slight male predominance for this condition. We now know that Caucasian populations as well as non-white Hispanic populations tend to have the highest risk of this condition, with African American and Asian populations having the lowest, and actually Pacific Islanders having the lowest. It's important to note that all of these studies that have shown this, most of them have been with Medicare beneficiaries. So we see this sort of trend mostly in people over the age of 65. We're not sure if under that age we see it, but there is definitely a growing incidence of Parkinson's disease around the world, with actually Asia, China specifically, and the US kind of heading the front. So studies have shown that there has been, you know, two times the number of Parkinson's patients over the last 25 years, and we're seeing those numbers increase significantly. Like I said, the U.S. and China are sort of heading the front of that. We're also seeing that if we stratify people between, you know, type, you know, geographic locations, industrialized versus rural, industrialized areas of these countries tend to have the highest risk, as well as a higher income status. So there's something about living in cities and maybe even, you know, the lifestyle that people have at a higher income that might portend a higher risk for developing this diagnosis. The diagnosis of Parkinson's, very similar to essential tremor, is still mainly a clinical diagnosis. We look for the main four cardinal symptoms, bradykinesia, plus one other typical symptom, muscular rigidity, an asymmetric rest tremor, and changes in the gait and posture to help us make the diagnosis. These all present with, you know, the typical classic look of a Parkinson's patient's: loss of facial expression, low volume voice, difficulty getting up out of a chair, turning in bed. They have little shuffled gait and freezing and problems with balance. We also know that there can be a whole slew of symptoms that are under the surface, what we call the non-motor symptoms, that many times can predate the physical symptoms. Things like constipation, acting out of dreams, what we call REM sleep behavior disorder, maybe some mild cognitive issues, even early in the condition, mood disorders, anxiety, depression. And we look for these when we're making the diagnosis to see if it all falls under a nice package of the condition that they have. But there's a whole other thing, you know, these can be early and they can start at any point in this condition: urinary dysfunction, sexual dysfunction, excessive daytime sleepiness, compulsivity and impulsive tendencies, hallucinations, delusional thoughts. So this is a very individual condition. We look for the classic symptoms, but everybody presents in a very different way in their constellation of symptoms and how they progress over time. So it's always very important to understand that if there's no tremor, it could still be Parkinson's. 30% of people with Parkinson's have no tremor. If they have a lot of gait issues, it could still be Parkinson's. We have pockets of people that we know are more tremor dominant, are more gait dominant, or maybe a mixture of all three. So the phenotype of Parkinson's can vary. We still don't understand the exact cause of Parkinson's. We know that in a smaller population of people, roughly about 5 to 10% of people, there can be a strong genetic component, sometimes runs in families, and we've been able to identify specific gene mutations, both autosomal dominant and recessive, that we know can cause Parkinson's. LRRK2, one of the most common mutations, synuclein, Parkin being the most common one. But that's only a small percentage of patients, and the rest, 90 to 95% of patients, what we call sporadic Parkinson's disease, may not have a strong family component. Yet we do feel that genetics may play a role, and we think that it is probably a complex interplay of genes that portend a susceptibility, a risk. Some of them could be the same genes that we have genetic mutations in, but now we have allelic variations that somehow can increase a person's risk and not directly cause it. Aging, we think, plays a significant role. As we get older, some of our natural processes of clearance of apoptosis don't work as efficiently. And then there's been brewing evidence of environmental exposures. And there's a lot of different theories, from pesticides to head trauma to heavy metals. The newest one is trichloroethylenes from cleaning fluids and degreasers. And we're starting to learn that it may be different for different people, the combination of genetic vulnerability combined with a specific trigger and a brain that just cannot handle the insult from aging. We see that there are some common themes pathologically in the brain. So there's oxidative stress and reactive oxidative radicals. There's neuroinflammation and microglial activation. There's proteasome dysfunction and poor clearance of toxic proteins. Energy pathways get affected, mitochondrial dysfunction, and there's excital toxicity. And we're not sure which one plays a role, or maybe they all play a role in different combinations. The final common pathway that we see is that there is conformation of native proteins, the biggest one being alpha-synuclein, that gets phosphorylated, hyperphosphorylated, becomes sticky, accumulates into oligomers that become insoluble, and then form inclusions, what we call Lewy body intraneuronal extracytoplasmic inclusions. These are been associated in areas where there is cell death. So there's, you know, multiple areas throughout the brain that accumulate Lewy bodies. We're still not sure if they're pathologic or just a marker of degeneration, but there's brewing evidence that alpha-synuclein, once it begins the cycle of Lewy body formation and oligomerization, that it may propagate like a prion protein. So because we don't know the exact cause of Parkinson's, we're still in the age of symptomatic therapies, with levodopa still being our gold standard. There's immediate release and controlled release. There's Parcopa, which is a disintegrating tablet. There's Rytary, which is the newest, no, it's not the newest, I apologize, capsule that has both immediate controlled release and intermediate release forms. We have Divi, which is a fractionated tablet for those people that cut their tablets into quarters and halves. We have an inhaler for people that wear out and need a rescue therapy. And we have the intestinal infusion Duopa, which I'll talk a little bit about. We have synthetic forms of dopamine, what we call dopamine agonists that come in oral forms. There's a new Pro patch, and there's an injectable form, again, as a rescue therapy for bad off periods. We have what we call enhancers of dopamine and levodopa. We have MAOB inhibitors and COMT inhibitors that try to decrease the metabolism of dopamine and levodopa and are many times added to levodopa. Anticholinergic medications, which are good for dystonia, rigidity, and tremor. And then we have amantadine in different formulations, which can help with the dyskinesias, but can also help with tremor. So, you know, when we start, how we use these medications over time can vary significantly from person to person. And we look at things like the age of the person, what's their predominant symptom? Is it tremor? Is it stiffness? Is it gait? What other comorbidities they have that this would affect. And so we really tailor it to the individual and change it over time. The majority of patients over time end up on levodopa and dopaminergic medications. And people are at risk for developing what's called, you know, motor complications. This is where the medication wears out between doses and they can develop the peak choreiform movements like Michael J. Fox. There is a myth that it is due to levodopa. The actual answer is that it is actually due to what's happening in the brain. Levodopa needs a very, you know, robust set of dopamine producing cells in the brain to be able to be taken up and spit out effectively as dopamine. But as the degeneration continues and there is not enough personnel in the factory to make dopamine out of levodopa, what happens is that people are susceptible to the pharmacokinetics of levodopa. So what happens is initially they get a good, nice, long release with levodopa. Then all of a sudden, you know, they have less time with levodopa and we need to start squeezing it together. And over time, levodopa lasts maybe 1 to 3 hours and, you know, at its peak may produce dyskinesias and in its trough, you know, people are back down to their symptoms without medication. So this happens to 95% or more of patients as the years progress, and it is par for the course. So we don't shy away from using levodopa. You can start patient 10 years into it and still develop dyskinesias and motor fluctuations from the get-go if they don't have the machinery to produce it effectively. We just have to be careful not to go too fast, too quickly. So one quick plug for Duopa. This has been out now, I think, since 2018. This is the only current infusible form of levodopa that's infused through a PEG J tube advanced to the jejunum. It has been shown against oral levodopa to really, from a pharmacokinetic standpoint, keep levodopa, plasma levodopa levels as steady as can be with any form of levodopa. It gives people more on time during the day, so less dips off the medication without necessarily worsening their dyskinesias. And this has been actually out in Scandinavia now for nearly 30 years. And we know from a long-term perspective, it can be very effective. Unfortunately, it does still involve placement of a PEG J tube and all its complications and frustrations. And for people to qualify, they need to have clearly defined response to levodopa but they have to have at least 2.5 to 3 hours of off time during the day, and they need to have tried other medications before they can qualify. So that's an option that people can have if people are significant fluctuating effects with the levodopa, but they're not candidates for surgery or don't want surgery. I'll just quickly talk about what's in the pipeline for Parkinson's. There's a variety of things that are currently in the FDA. There's a newer formulation of Rytary, which is about to come out this year. It's an oral capsule with delayed release beads and a mucoadhesive polymer that adheres to the intestinal wall. So that it gives a much slower release of levodopa during the day. There are also newer formulations of dopamine agonists that are just as effective as our current ones, but have less of the cognitive and hallucinatory side effects because they work more on the D1 and not the D2 receptors. There's also other infusible forms of levodopa, as well as a dopamine agonist called apomorphine that is given subcutaneously, as the picture shows here, much like an insulin pump, where studies looking at these have shown, like the duodopa, is able to recreate more of a steady pharmacokinetics with levodopa than any of our oral medications. So these are currently going through the FDA right now. What's more exciting is some of these disease-modifying therapies that are been looking at, things that are trying to target more the production and of aggregated alpha-synuclein, whether it is preventing the hyperphosphorylation or the oligomerization of alpha-synuclein. There's also still in the works a vaccine of IV humanized monoclonal antibody against aggregated alpha-synuclein. Both of these are sort of receiving a lot of interest and are in phase 2 trials. They're looking at drugs that could decrease microglial activation. These are some of the currently available diabetes drugs that seem to have an effect in trials of Parkinson's disease. They're looking at some of the anti-apoptotic drugs that are available. Some of them are current neuro-oncology drugs or oncology drugs. They are looking at some of the gene targets, so some of the two highest risk genes, the LRRK2 gene and the glucocerebrosidase gene, which is associated with risk in families where the gene, the actual gene mutation, may cause Gaucher's disease and portend increased risk in adults in that family, as well as there's been a renewed interest in cell-based therapies, especially dopaminergic, surgically implanted pure dopaminergic cells. So these are sort of the products that currently are receiving the most interest. Most are still in phase 1 or phase 2 trials. A few are hitting phase 3 trials. So we're looking forward to see if we maybe are on the cusp of developing some true disease modifying therapies. So I'm going to switch gears now to surgical interventions for Parkinson's disease. Surgery for Parkinson's disease has been around since the 1950s, since they started doing ablations of the ventral intermediate nucleus, the subthalamic nucleus, the globus pallidus internus. And we know that surgical ablation of those areas can bring significant benefit for tremor and for Parkinson's symptoms. Unfortunately, lesional therapies of this type that have been around have sort of fallen out of favor if DBS is an option, because they're still only done unilaterally. When done bilaterally, they can cause bulbar side effects. Getting the precise lesion size so that people have adequate effect, but not too big so that they have side effects. And also there can be a risk of radiation toxicity with stereotactic radiosurgery. So these are still used in places or countries where DBS is not an option, but DBS has actually become our standard of therapy. And more recently, there has been renewed interest in lesional therapies with MRI-guided high-intensity focused ultrasound. So I'll talk a little bit about these. So deep brain stimulation, as I mentioned, has been around now for, you know, more than two decades. There's hundreds of thousands of people globally that have undergone DBS. And in this country, I was told that there were 12,000 new patients every year that are getting DBS. For movement disorders, it's approved for Parkinson's disease, essential tremor, and dystonia. And we really shouldn't, as I'll talk about in a second, see it as a last resort for patients. We want to catch patients when they're still functional so we can keep them functional. And the advantage is that, like I said, it's got 20 years of data since its initial approval in 1997. It's adjustable over time as people's symptoms progress. And in the hands of a good surgeon, you know, the risk perioperatively and postoperatively is on the order of 1% to 3% of some of the major, you know, things like hemorrhage, stroke, infection that can occur with any type of brain surgery. So in terms of DBS for essential tremor, well, it's been around. This was one of the first indications for movement disorders in 1997. Initially approved as unilateral therapy, but over time, and initially unilateral because of that fear of worsening speech and swallow that we saw with lesional therapies, but eventually approved for bilateral thalamic VIM DBS. And as I'll talk about, you know, we have learned that not only does it not provoke these symptoms, but with our new programming platforms, we're actually able to improve some of the bulbar tremors that people can have. The proper patient is somebody that has medically refractory ET, meaning that they've moderate to severe tremor. The tremor interferes significantly with their daily activities. They have tried and optimized their medical therapy, but either they didn't tolerate it or didn't get enough benefit. And there's been numerous studies looking at DBS for ET with at least a 70% improvement in limb tremor, sometimes up to near resolution of tremor. And as I mentioned, with some of our newer programming techniques, if somebody has head tremor or voice tremor, we can actually really make a dent in that and significantly reduce that as well these days with our new programming techniques. The drawback is that studies have shown that over time, the effect of DBS may wane after about 5, 6, 7 years, but this was thought to be due to tolerance, you know, from the DBS. We oftentimes tell people to turn off their DBS at night, but not a lot of patients can tolerate that. So more recently, with some of our programming platforms that we have, we can have patients have multiple groups so that there's a day group and a night group, or they can shift between programs in their stomach so that the brain doesn't build tolerance to it. And some of the newer studies say that we can avoid this worsening of tremor over time. What about for Parkinson's disease? Well, we know that there are two targets that we use, or actually three, because we do use thalamic DBS for people that have very strong tremor with their Parkinson's disease, especially if it's more of an action tremor in our tremor dominant PD. But for their other motor symptoms, we can either do STN or GPI. Generally, STN or subthalamic nuclease tends to be better for those patients that have tremor and allows us many times to decrease their medication, sometimes even get rid of their medication, but it can have cognitive and hallucinatory and other behavioral issues. So we definitely try to select out patients that do not have significant and problematic cognitive and psychiatric issues. GPI tends to be better for disabling dyskinesias or if somebody has a strong dystonia as part of their Parkinson's, but we rarely are able to make a significant dent. We do sometimes, but not a significant dent. The bright light about GPI is we generally don't have some of these cognitive and psychiatric issues with GPI. Now, there have been, you know, DBS for Parkinson's was initially approved in 2002. So we have multiple, many, you know, randomized control trials looking at the different targets of DBS versus best medical therapy or optimized therapy, and all have shown significant benefit with reduction of their motor symptoms in the off state by 30 to 50%. So their off periods are much better and tolerable. They have more on time during the day, 2 to 5 hours. And we can improve their dyskinesias, improve their quality of life and their functional abilities, and titrate it to the person. A good thing too is we've been able to find a continued, you know, we have studies now going 15 or more years, and the effect of Parkinson's DBS, it has continued. It's always important to understand that those symptoms that do not respond to levodopa or lose effect to levodopa over the years will have the same problem with DBS. So if somebody never responded to dopaminergic medications, they are not going to respond to levodopa. If, you know, the axial symptoms, swallow, loss of postural reflex, and then the non-motor symptoms sometimes do not respond well to DBS. So we look for patients that have Parkinson's disease for at least 4 years. So that should be enough time to flesh out, you know, atypical Parkinson's or other forms of Parkinson's that clearly have a good response to levodopa. And we see a difference between on and off, and either they're not able to tolerate the medicines, they have fluctuations in their effect with off periods, off medication periods that are disabling, or peak dyskinesias that are disabling. The caveat to this is tremor. If they have significant tremor that never responded to tremor and we're clear that somebody has Parkinson's disease, that's the one thing that can also really respond to DBS. And we try to select out patients that have no significant cognitive impairment or psychiatric disease. Now, it was initially approved for advanced Parkinson's disease, but in 2013, there was a study published in New England Journal looking to see, well, can we implant people earlier and maybe could that prevent people from progressing and worsening in their motor complications? And what we found is that, yes, if we implant people that have had Parkinson's for a good 4 years, again, that's more to flesh out, you know, patients that don't have Parkinson's disease and are just beginning to have motor complications. So maybe 3 or 4 months of motor complications would suffice, but they're clearly, they've been optimized in their therapy, medical therapy. They clearly have wearing off or dyskinesias that is bothersome. The study did show, and there's a couple that have replicated, that we can improve their motor complications and maintain them better longer over time. So there's 3 main companies that do DBS. There's Medtronic, which was the original, Abbott, and Boston Scientific, and we use all 3. There have been significant advantages over the last couple of years. All 3 systems now have the newest available platforms, have rechargeable batteries that go out to at least 15 years. All of the newest models for all 3 companies are now MRI compatible. They all now have what we call directional leads that either fragment, each content is fragmented so that we can direct the stimulation and cause what we can do programming that's called current steering. So we can move the stimulation to where we need and try to reduce any unwanted side effects. We can now have different frequencies and pulse widths for different types of the brain, depending if there's tremor on one side and rigidity and stiffness and bradykinesia on the other. And Abbott now has, over the last 5 years, they came out with something that is called Neurosphere that combines a telehealth visit with remote programming over Bluetooth. So we can sort of lock in with patients in their home. If they live far away or coming into the clinic is difficult, we can lock in and make some minor programming adjustments if needed. So, you know, once patients have gone through surgery, once patients have, you know, healed from the surgery, and we generally give them 3 to 4 weeks, then the patient gets released back to their neurologist that's going to be doing the programming. And there's been some exciting new programs that have come out over the last couple of years that have made programming much more easy and faster and better results for the patients. So they're, you know, Boston Scientific and Medtronic have programs that we use for image-guided programming. So they fuse their pre-op imaging with their post-op imaging so we can get a representation of what the lead looks like in the patient's brain, their target structure. And we can often see what are the best contacts to use. So, you know, patients, when they used to come to us before we had these programs, it would take 2 or 3 hours of testing each contact. What is the threshold for benefit? What is the threshold for adverse events? And, you know, then once we picked on the first session, then we would have to kind of over the course of weeks and sometimes months sort of fine tune it. Now we can sort of go in to the contacts that are best placed in the target structure and start from there. We also have, Medtronic has something that's called Brain Sense. These contacts can now pick up local field potentials, local brain signals. They're thought to represent these pathological oscillations of groups of cells that we think jam up the communication in the basal ganglia, causing some of the motor symptoms. And as we've learned more about these LFPs, we've learned that there are certain frequency bands, like beta frequency is associated with rigidity and bradykinesia, whereas alpha frequency more associated with tremor, and gamma tends to be more prokinetic and sometimes be seen with dyskinesias. So you can see here, we can look at the different contacts that a patient has and see where they have a increased peak of oscillatory activity in the different contacts and kind of start programming from there. And we can use this in a very interesting way. So a patient can record when they're experiencing specific symptoms, tremor, gait problems, even non-motor symptoms, also log in when they're having, when they're taking their medications, and do these symptoms occur at times where there's peak oscillatory activity. So you can see there, we can use them for programming. So you can see, you know, peaks of oscillatory activity in the beta or alpha range that can help us decide which contact to use. And we can also stream while we're programming. So as you can see the oscillatory activity here, and we start ramping up our stimulation, and you can see the LFP band power starts to decrease. And we try to correlate that with the patient's symptoms. So this is a window into the brain that allows us to be more objective and sort of streamline our programming of the patient. So I have a few cases, if I'm not running too much out of time, I'm okay. This is a lady that we've seen and they've all consented to show. This is a typical lady with essential tremor. Hopefully it's projecting. You can see she's got a little bit of spillover to rest tremor. She's got a head tremor. She has difficulty putting that pen down. You can see the typical tremor that you can have in essential tremor. You know, with her image guided, we chose from the beginning what was going to be the contact we were going to use. And that's been her contact since then. You can see from the get-go, we were able to reduce her tremor. She's able to hold a phone. You could see the difference in her spirals. So even from the get-go, we got a significant reduction in her dominant hand and in her tremor. This is a gentleman with tremor dominant Parkinson's disease. You know, had significant amount of tremor, but, you know, once he had rest tremor and typical when he's walking, and as you'll see in a second, he also had a significant amount of postural and action tremor. So it took him a time to get diagnosed because people kept confusing this for essential tremor. And as you'll see, we had contacts on the image guided that helped us hone in on which ones were perfectly situated in the thalamic target. We had good alpha peaks in those areas, those targets that we just talked that you can see there. So his local field potentials peaks aligned with the images that we had and the targets that we chose. And that's what we chose. And as you can see, significant reduction in tremor. He's very happy. And we did this, you know, within one visit or two. Lastly, we have this gentleman who was very gait predominant and had some foot dystonia also when he was walking. He said it was not related. They swore it was not related to the timing of his medications, but then we had them start logging in. I take my medicine, check. This is when my walking happened, check. And here's where we recorded his brain signals and we would see peaks of activity related to his medications. Well, we saw that he had this beta peak there when he reported that he was off. And when we implanted him, we would see this. So then once we were able to hone in on that, you can see how significantly different his gait is. Not needing a walker when at this time. So I'm not going to focus too much on the future of DBS other than ideally we're moving into the age of what we call adaptive or closed loop DBS, where these contacts will learn when patients have symptoms and when they have this oscillatory activity and give on-demand stimulation. So once it learns these oscillatory waves of activity in a patient's brain and how they relate to a person's sort of symptoms, the contact and the system will learn to just give periods of stimulation without it being continuous, what we call a biofeedback loop. And Medtronic is actually doing a worldwide, North America and Europe trial looking at this new closed loop system. Yeah. Very quickly, I'll talk about MRI-guided focused ultrasound because this has received a lot of interest from the patient community. This was initially approved in 2016 for essential tremor. It's a new form of a lesional procedure where patients' MRI targets the ventral intermedius nucleus of the thalamus, and a cap is worn that gives high intensity focused ultrasound waves to create, you know, heat up that nucleus and create an ablative lesion. The advantages are it's not a surgery, there's no anesthesia, it's a same day procedure, it's an immediate effect, and if effective, that's it. You know, they don't need medications and follow-up is not necessary if it helps their symptoms, especially for essential tremor. The problem is that it's not adjustable over time. So if it's not right, or if there's still some symptom and it progresses over time, it's a one and done procedure. One and done is good, but if it's not done right, or if it doesn't take away the symptoms completely, there's no way to adjust it over time. And there is some loss of efficacy. So initially approved for essential tremor in 2016, unilateral, more now in 2002, we can do bilateral, but it's staged over the course of 9 months. It's been shown to produce slightly less than DBS in effect, 60 to 70% improvement in tremor from the get-go, right? So it's not a buildup. And studies have shown that people can have to about 5 years of good maintained tremor, but like DBS, there's been a reduction in its effect after about 3 to 5 years in about 10% of patients. So with DBS, we were starting to learn how to work past that return of symptoms with our new programming. Unfortunately, with essential tremor, not yet. In terms of Parkinson's disease, it was approved for just unilateral tremor dominant Parkinson's disease in the thalamus in 2018, and now also in 2021 for unilateral pallidotomy in patients that have moderate to severe motor complications. It's been shown to significantly reduce dyskinesias and can reduce other motor symptoms to about 40 to 50%. And thus far, we've got about a year to a year and a half of data that shows that people can have continued improvement in their symptoms at the same level. But at this point, it's still unilateral. You know, it's a brewing technology, especially for people that maybe definitely don't want DBS, but or are not candidates for DBS. If people have cognitive issues that preclude them or other medical issues that preclude them from having surgery, this may be an option for patients. But I think the data is still kind of early. But it's definitely being used significantly throughout the country. So in summary, Parkinson's and essential tremor are two most common movement disorders, and they span decades with progressive disability. And unfortunately, we are seeing more and more of it in our clinics. Current management for both is only symptomatic, and efficacy can vary for people, and there can be long-term complications with therapy. We do have now more advanced therapies with DBS and MRI-guided focused ultrasound that can offer more significant and longer-term efficacy for select patients with these conditions. And DBS has now got, more than 20 years of experience. So in the select group of patients that it's good for and decide to do it, we have been able to show good long-term efficacy if we select out the right patients. So that's my talk. Hopefully we have a little bit of time for questions and answers.
Yeah, we have plenty of time, and there seems to be a lot of questions here. We'll just sit together here. That was a phenomenal talk, Dr. Diaz, a powerhouse presentation as expected. Let me stop the share so we can pull them up here. So Dr. Walensky asks, what is the present data on percentage of essential tremor patients that progress to Parkinson's disease? And over what median time after tremor onset, especially with a family history of both?
Yeah, that's really interesting, right? We have definitely seen over decades that sometimes both conditions can run in a family. And there's actually some newer data that shows that having essential tremor in the family and a person having essential tremor may portend a higher risk to developing Parkinson's disease. Now, I don't know that I can give you an exact number of how many people convert. I don't know that that number is truly out there, but there is definitely data brewing that if you have essential tremor, as you age, you have a higher risk of developing Parkinson's disease, right? Now, some of those patients have come to autopsy, and of course that we've got dual pathology in some of those patients. So are they completely separate disorders that you have sort of maybe a genetic predisposition towards essential tremor? And then with aging, you get thrown into the general population at risk for Parkinson's disease. But I think there is some brewing data that some of the pathology that we see and some of the genetics that we see in essential tremor, those patients may actually have a higher risk of developing Parkinson's.
Dr. Khalili asked a great question. Do any blood thinners besides warfarin affect levels of primidone, such as the new dual oral anticoagulants?
Yeah, absolutely. All of the direct agents can interact with primidone. So we generally recommend that patients don't take primidone if they're on those. Now, Coumadin, you can do because we can monitor drug levels, right? So I have had a couple patients that have been on Coumadin and really do well on primidone. And so we haven't wanted to take them off, and we just monitor their Coumadin levels and keep them in therapeutic range. Obviously, it's harder with some of the new direct agents, right? And so we generally recommend that people try to avoid primidone if they're on anticoagulants, the newer anticoagulants.
I haven't heard this question before. What is the, is there a link between restless leg syndrome and increased risk of Parkinson's disease?
Yeah, that's still a question. There's a, maybe a slightly higher risk of RLS if people have Parkinson's, but we haven't been able to find a direct link. Obviously, both are thought to have some dopaminergic component, which is why all restless legs patients respond to dopamine agonists. It's believed to be, you know, in a different area of the nervous system, but there's a slightly higher risk of restless legs in Parkinson's, but we don't really see it as one of the prodromal syndromes for Parkinson's. REM sleep behavior disorder, there's a significant amount of patients that if they start with that will transform to Parkinson's. I mean, studies have shown like 80% of patients with REM sleep disorder. Constipation, which obviously can be very nonspecific, and mood disorders, all of which have been strongly associated as prodromal, but we don't really see RLS as necessarily a prodrome of Parkinson's.
Dr. Yazdi asks, can vestibular neuritis and Parkinson's disease have common features, or can they be confused for one another?
Not necessarily, although, you know, do we often have patients that come to us for present with dizziness, right? So yes, that is a common complaint that I hear. It can be, you know, could be orthostatic, you know, and they just don't know how to, they just say, I'm dizzy. I'm dizzy. I get up and I move around and I'm dizzy. There is also a population of patients, and I've seen them some in practice, that complain of this nonspecific dizziness. We do Dick's Hall Pike, we check their blood pressure, and nothing that we're able to find, you know, we used to send them for tilt tables and all that sort of stuff, and nothing. And once I start them on dopaminergic medication, they feel better. So my question has always been, could that be some component of anxiety that they express as dizziness, you know, or some other, you know, symptom of Parkinson's that's nonspecific? But the only way that I can relate the two is if they're complaining of just nonspecific dizziness.
Wow, that's so great, because I've been wondering where to send all my dizziness patients. That's me. That's right, me. Across the hall. Dr. Nelson asks, is progression of the tremor and or the risk of other neuropathologic degeneration like dementia greater for early onset essential tremor or with those for later?
Yeah, it tends to be for later, right? So this ET plus syndrome that I mentioned, right, which we think those are the ones that tend to have more of a degenerative component that's been seen in autopsy. And this is kind of well described, not always accepted, but some of the bigger MDS groups, we all believe in it. These tend to be older onset patients. They tend to have, you know, some spillover to rest. They can tend to have some walking difficulties that tend to be more wide-based. They're not the shuffling gait. They can have some cognitive difficulties. And so there's always that confusion. Are we looking at essential tremor? Or are we looking at tremor-dominant Parkinson's disease? And those are the patients also that tend to have a higher risk of actually developing Parkinson's disease and have Lewy bodies in their brain. The people that start early tend to be the people that have the strongest risk for familial essential tremor and tend to have the highest prevalence for the more pure just tremor and not the ET plus. Obviously, not everybody fits that mold, but that's where we're seeing that distribution and risk.
Great question. Dr. Israhi asks, is smoking is known to be protective for Parkinson's disease, but does anybody know why?
Yeah, I don't know. That's something that's been studied. Smoking and caffeine for a number of years has been looked at. You know, we do know that both of them affect some neurotransmitters in the brain, like adenosine. I mean, caffeine and smoking can affect adenosine in the brain. Adenosine is thought to be a neuromodulator of dopamine, and people have tried to recreate this effect either by patches or, you know, compounds that look like adenosine or may look like nicotine and caffeine to kind of create that sort of effect. But nobody's been able to recreate that.
Interesting. Dr. Laborde asks, for essential tremor in pediatric patients, are there different proposed treatments compared to what was discussed for the adults?
No, we tend to, and I don't see a lot of pediatric, but we tend to kind of use the same. And I tend to, the few patients that I saw in my prior life with essential tremor at a very young age, and these are usually types that have a strong family history of tremor. In fact, there's a lot of people that, you know, will tell you, I had tremor since I was a kid. I was always a tremulous kid. You know, if I got nervous or I had to get up in front of the class, I would tremor. But it's not until I got older that it became a problem and sought medical care. But generally, I think we tend to go more for something like, you know, propranolol, just because it doesn't have some of the same cognitive side effects that some of the other ones can. And, you know, you don't want children having to do that. We'll try the devices and aids, as I mentioned, but generally only if tremor really becomes, you know, an intrusive.
Dr. Naparko asked, does bupropion or, you know, a dopamine reuptake inhibitor treat early Parkinson's or increase the risk of Parkinson's disease?
Neither. So, you know, we don't believe that bupropion actually, you know, really, I know theoretically a lot of people have thought about this and looked at it, but we don't believe that it actually changes the nature of Parkinson's disease. We use it, I use it mostly if I have a patient that is very apathetic or has, you know, maybe some problems with sedation during the day, as bupropion tends to be a little bit more activating than some of the other mood drugs, but there's no real evidence that it changes the you know, pathology that's going on in Parkinson's disease.
I love these questions here. Dr. Armato asks, is there any insight on the several recent publications on transcutaneous vagal nerve stimulation as well as GLT-2 inhibitors on the gait and dystonia issues of Parkinson's disease?
I don't know that I have a lot of information, to be honest with you, in the SGLT2 inhibitors. You know, transcutaneous vagal nerve stimulation. Yeah, there's some brewing evidence that might, and it's very early, really very early stages at this time.
Dr. Naparko asks also, is there any peer-reviewed opinion on nanoplastics contribute? Yeah, that's a great question.
There's a lot of different theories, and I don't know that. I mean, like I mentioned, the ones that I put up there are the major ones. I know that the sort of environmental theory du jour are these that I call the TCEs, right? The trichloroethylenes that are very prevalent in our society, cleaning fluids, dry cleaning, degreasers, right? So there's been a lot of discussion in our movement disorder meetings about this.
Yeah, that's always a topic of great debate there. Dr. Ross asks, what is the effect of following PET scans in Parkinson's disease?
Yeah, we don't really use PET scans now. We used to use F-DOPA PETs. You know, now we use the SPECT scan, the DAT-SPECT, which is available here at Little Company of Mary. There's been no evidence per se outside of research that, and that's still being looked at as to whether it accurately tracks the progression of the disease. And I'm not sure that it's clinically useful for patients to put them through that. We use them for diagnostic purposes, right? So I didn't want to go too much into that, but you know, sometimes if there is a question, you have somebody that has a lot of tremor and you're questioning whether it's ET or PD or they're on neuroleptics and you can't take them off of it, or you know, they take a long time to sort of wean out of your system. We can use the SPECT scans to help us diagnose. They let us know that there is actually a degenerative process happening in the brain. Rather, you know, you wouldn't see that in ET or neurodegenerative, in neuroleptics or post-stroke. So we use those for diagnosing, but we don't really use them to monitor. Some clinical trials are starting to use it, but, you know, with what we have available right now, it's not worth it. It's too costly, and it doesn't really clinically help us in their management.
That's going to lead us to a couple of these additional ones. Dr. An asks, were you able to, or can you speak a little bit about GL, P.S. Similar question, Dr. Amato. Is GLP agonist delaying the neurodegenerative disease like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's?
Right. There's been a lot of interest in these GLP-1 agonists, right? So like a lot of the newer anti-diabetic drugs are GLP-1 agonists, right? Glucagon-like protein 1, right? So, you know, there's been brewing evidence in Parkinson's and Alzheimer's that the brain can build some insulin resistance, right? So that was the initial idea, that by helping the brain better utilize glucose, that it might help it retain some of these cells and prevent neurodegeneration. But there's more mechanisms that are associated with these that we see in animals. So we think that it helps prevent or reduce microglial activation, and maybe even help in the apoptotic pathway. So they've been testing a number of these GLP agonists that have already been out, like exenatide was one that they looked at. There was a Cedars-Sinai did liraglutide, if I can pronounce that correctly. Unfortunately, the most recent one with exenatide didn't really show much benefit, but there are some newer ones that they're testing right now, and that's the believed mechanism. You know, we think it's probably geared more towards neuroinflammation than actually insulin glucose utilization.
Dr. Sankumarik asks, what the treatments that you discussed, were they mostly for primary Parkinson's disease, or can some of them work for the secondary Parkinson-like symptoms?
Yeah, so if you're alluding to like our Parkinson's plus or our atypical symptoms, right? So, you know, generally these are conditions that don't respond as well to these medications, dopaminergic medications, and can have more potential side effects from them, right? Cognitive, blood pressure issues, hallucinatory. But here's where we give people 4 years of Parkinson's diagnosis before we even consider surgery, because some of these patients, and you know, studies have documented, you know, upwards to 30% of these atypicals or secondary forms can have some dopamine response in the beginning. But traditionally that response wears out, and then it becomes more obvious as time goes on that we're not dealing with typical Parkinson's. Now, when we talk about, you know, giving people a challenge of Parkinson's if they don't respond, obviously we have to be careful that we, you know, are not dealing with Parkinson's and we could provoke some of these motor complications. But generally, you know, one tablet 3 times a day of Sinemet is not enough to say somebody has had a good challenge. So we'll take them up to 600 milligrams a day, at least of levodopa, before we say they've been, you know, challenged with levodopa. But yes, sometimes in the very beginning, these secondary forms can. Even vascular Parkinson's, sometimes we will try the dopaminergic medications, because sometimes people can have a slight benefit. And if they can get anything that improves their gait and their symptoms, we'll try it.
We have some interesting questions on bladder-related pathology. Dr. Samadhi asks, have you treated anyone with bladder or sphincter issues and incontinence?
Yeah, that's really funny. So, you know, occasionally the bladder responds to some of these therapies that I've just talked about. So occasionally, levodopa and dopaminergic therapies, people respond. I've heard it. With surgery too, sometimes with some people, we get response. So we see what we get with all these therapies. Mm-hmm. You know, bladder issues can be very common, you know, from frequency to urgency to hesitancy, sometimes leading to urge incontinence. Obviously, if you have severe symptoms early on and people are already incontinent a year or two into it, we could be looking either at something else, you know, an atypical form like multiple system atrophy, or possibly even normal pressure hydrocephalus if that's what's going on. But yeah, so we'll try bladder agents. I try to, I'll use the traditional more anticholinergic ones in people that are younger and can tolerate it. I'll go for the more modern, like mirabegron or Gemtesa, that don't have as much cardiovascular or cognitive side effects. Or sometimes patients, you know, I'll refer them to urology. Sometimes Botox can help for some of these patients. Sphincter, you know, Botoxing the sphincter can sometimes help these patients.
Very cool. And can a patient with DBS have a simultaneous posterior nerve stimulator placed for overactive bladder?
I don't know. The answer to the honest answer to that is I don't know. Haven't tried it and haven't been there. I'm not sure that they can. That would probably be a good question for our neurosurgeon. So I'm not sure, to be honest with you. But DBS patients can have the duodopa. So I was talking about those infusible things. So occasionally we have patients that start with Parkinson's disease very young, and we get them onto DBS and we significantly improve their symptoms, but they still can have some fluctuations. They're not as severe, but they are definitely getting benefit with the DBS. So we need more than what we have, and oral medications aren't doing it. So occasionally we run into somebody who has got a DBS as well as an infusible form of levodopa.
With the new monitors, I think being able to monitor these people in real time and get that effect, that's going to be really exciting with Duopa and things.
Yeah, no, this has been the new platforms for DBS programming have been incredible. Not only do we get it sooner, our programming time and in-clinic time has been less, and people get much better effect without the potential of side effects. We're able to kind of work our way around, the nearby structures that normally give some of the side effects as we steer current more to where we need to.
This era of personalized medicine here, it's awesome. Dr. Briganti asks, with treatments 1 and 2, if the patient is on such treatment, let me get to the next question there. Are there concerns with college students and chem labs on chemical exposure and PD? It's a good question.
It's a good question. I'm not sure. I'm not aware of any data on that. Obviously we have seen pockets of increased Parkinson's disease and, epidemiologic studies that have looked across the country where people live, where people grew up, what exposures there have, people that live sort of in the Midwest where there's been more sort of factories and mills and they've grew up in those areas. People that live in farming communities tend to have a higher risk, especially if they've been long-term exposure. People that have worked in, welding and contracting where they weld. People that have, I have a number of families that, going along with this TCE, I just saw a patient that, worked in a dry cleaning business all their life. Family had a dry cleaning business and multiple family members, people that have been vets and exposed to chemicals, during their tours of duty, there's been increasing evidence of that. So, there's pockets that we're learning more about, but there's probably lots of exposures that are happening that, in somebody who is susceptible and the brain can't handle whatever trigger that they come across in their life. That's what we think kind of brings on this cascade.
I'm going to try to combine a couple of these questions for the purposes of time and the interest in time. Dr. Vashishta and Dr. Y are asking, are there any links between stutter and tremor? And then other congenital dyskinesia and dystonia, does that increase your lifetime risk of dementia and Parkinson's disease?
Okay, so I'm trying to understand what's meant by stutter and tremor. So, stutter, whether it's vocal stutter or limb stutter, people use those terms sometimes. I get up to walk and I can't walk, my leg tremors or it stutters. So I hear that. And that's usually gait freezing. People can also have a stuttering speech sometimes with Parkinson's, can also be, seen in some of our atypical Parkinson's condition. I'm trying to remember the question, but I'm wondering if that's what they meant.
The link, yeah.
Yeah, the link, but in terms of people that have childhood stuttering, I'm not sure that there's been a specific link. Somebody asked about childhood or early onset dystonia and dyskinesia. So, early onset dystonia tends to be more commonly a generalized dystonia when people start in childhood. we always have to select out that they don't have something like DOPA responsive dystonia. And so many of these children, if they start at a young age, levodopa is one thing we definitely test to see if there's a levodopa response. Traditionally, people with DOPA responsive dystonia don't tend to have as good a response with some of our surgical therapies as the typical Parkinson's patient that, you know, does not have that history of dystonia.
There are so many questions here. If we can't get to everyone, also to touch on Dr. Joshi's fantastic talk, more of this, please. Yeah, we'll definitely bring Dr. Diaz back for either an extension of this or, you know, a continuation in a couple of years. Because even between 4 years ago when we last gave this talk, it's essentially a brand, you know, so new in so many ways. It's incredible how fast this field is growing. We will get these talks uploaded to YouTube as well. They're already there on the PNI website under Grand Rounds, and you'll see them. Dr. Solarte asks, THC or CBD, any effects on movement disorders? And what about the recreational use and the counterpart of that and the future development of these diseases?
Yeah, that's always an interesting question. It's something that very commonly patients bring up these days, right? The use of cannabinoids. And, you know, the Parkinson's Foundation took up this question a couple of years ago because there was so much patient and caregiver interest about cannabinoids in Parkinson's disease. And the answer, honest answer is, we don't have good evidence to either recommend or refute people using these, right? There is some, you know, very beginning evidence that in some patients with a lot of tremor, it may help tremor. Like in MS, if people have a lot of muscular spasticity, or in our term, more rigidity, and they're having pain from that, it can help with pain and muscle relaxation. There is some mild evidence that if people have significant dyskinesias, it can help with that. Generally, I talk to patients whenever we're having a lot of problems with insomnia. It can help with insomnia in patients, especially CBD. And so I have a lot of patients on that right now. I know that our psychiatrists have been using it for anxiety control. For a lot of patients, CBD can help with if they have a lot of anxiety, either around the time of bedtime or even during the day. Microdosing, low, you know, some CBD can sometimes be useful for that. THC is kind of a trickier subject, right? Because THC has some evidence that it can be activating, can maybe help speed up mobility a little bit, but there can also be a lot of unwanted side effects, especially since we're looking at an older population of people. So, you know, I've definitely seen the hallucinogenic part, you know, side effect of THC in people that are trying to balance that CBD THC component. But generally, the recommendations from Michael J. Fox, the Parkinson's Foundation, the American Parkinson's Disease Association, is as of right now, we still cannot recommend and say that it truly helps the motor symptoms of Parkinson's.
Now that the classification of the drug is better, we can actually study it in a formal way. So we should have data on that.
Yeah.
Hopefully not in the not too distant future.
Well, it's the difficulty is finding funding, absolutely, right? Because it's not easy to find funding for those trials.
I think we really have to get to a GLP agonist talk here about the effects on neurologics, because every month now we're getting this. But Dr. Marsh asks, do you use diabetic medications off-label at all yet for PD?
I don't. I don't know that we're there yet to say. I really try to avoid, you know, I know patients get very excited about it. Mm-hmm. I think if you have to treat their diabetes and they have Parkinson's, there you have an opportunity. But if they purely have Parkinson's, I really try to avoid that because, you know, they can have unwanted side effects. And without my having good evidence yet that it really can slow this progression down, I don't like to put people on these medications. It was the same thing with, you know, a few years ago when there was the craze over nilotinib, you know, an oncology drug that was shown to maybe make symptomatically people better, but and possibly slow down the condition. And every patient would call me up and say, can you please prescribe nilotinib for me? And the honest answer was, no, I can't, because, you know, these medications can have their toxicities and their side effects. And until we understand or get to a point that we know, there's a lot of things that look really good in animals and look really good in early stages, you know, early trials of Parkinson's disease that just don't pan out.
But thankfully, they're all super cheap, right? It don't cost the healthcare system
much. Yeah.
Just kidding, of course. Yeah. For drug-induced Parkinsonianism, like psychiatric treatments, has DBS been used as a treatment for that once tremors start?
No, in those, you know, in those sort of situations, you know, if people have tardive dyskinesia, you know, the groups have looked at, you know, using DBS for people that have severe tardive dyskinesia, if they haven't responded to some of our VMAT inhibitors that we have now, and it's really, you know, severe dyskinesia that intrudes. So some people are using DBS for those patients, but in drug-induced Parkinsonism, no, DBS traditionally does not help.
We have some great questions here from Dr. Walensky again. For anyone who's had optimal DBS results using the new Boston Scientific device compared to others, are there any specific settings or anything like that? I know it's a very nuanced question, but a lot of excitement with the new Boston Scientific device.
Yeah. I mean, so I'm sorry, the question is,
have you found more optimal specific results with the device?
With Boston Scientific in general, or just
the new one? Yeah, the new.
You know, again, as all these companies come out with new platforms, and again, there's no one algorithm for every patient across the board, right? We tend to look at what predominant symptoms they have. So, you know, if they have a significant amount of tremor, many times we'll try higher frequencies. We're also learning that lower pulse width sometimes can be good for people with a significant amount of tremor. So, you know, sometimes we'll play around with those parameters, but really it's just to make sure that we're on target on the areas that we want to be and are getting some effect. And then really sometimes it becomes trial and error. So if we need to fine tune, we try adjusting their frequency, we try adjusting their pulse width. Sometimes we can do what's called double monopolar, meaning that we will turn on two contacts either right next to each other, or now we can do two contacts that are even separate from each other that are both on and stimulating, and one may help gait and one may help tremor. So there's different ways that we can adjust this program now, which is incredible. But it's very patient specific. I'm happy if there's any programmers out there that have specific patient questions. You know, Wally can share my email. I'm always happy if people are out there programming and they have any questions. I'm happy to, you know, discuss with them things that I've tried and see if it works.
And you'll have the contact information with the talk and everything afterwards. What is the utility, again, from Dr. Walensky, of the DAT scan to detect pre-symptomatic Parkinson's disease and any decision-making for timing of DBS?
Right. So please keep in mind that DBS is not a therapy that you're going to start at diagnosis, mm-hmm. right? Right now, it is only approved for patients who have had Parkinson's at least 4 years and either have disabling tremor or they're beginning to have motor complications. They've actually looked at patients that are even earlier than that, and so far the data doesn't suggest that we can prevent that from happening. So we don't generally see DBS as an early therapy at this point. In terms of using DAT scans for preclinical sort of diagnosis, right? I would say that in our current time, unless we're able to offer patients, none of the therapies that we have available right now are considered neuroprotective or disease modifying. So to give that patient that diagnosis very early is not necessarily useful for them, because then they're constantly worrying about things. Having said that, we can sometimes, there are studies that are looking for patients that are very early in the condition for some of these disease modifying therapies, but all of them must have motor symptoms that meet that criteria, and then we'll do a DAT scan to confirm. Now, it's really interesting because I mentioned prodromal, like, you know, REM sleep behavior disorder, and that's an area where there's been a lot of interest trying to find people that are in that stage of REM sleep behavior disorder, but still have not developed motor symptoms, because a lot of these patients, you know, upwards of 80% of these patients will over time develop, you know, Parkinsonism. So from a research perspective, there's been a lot of interest to try to, how do we identify these patients? Should we be doing these tests so that maybe when we have disease modifying trials that can pick up people and put them on these medications early before they develop motor symptoms? But that's still in the works.
Very interesting. Are there any companies besides Boston Scientific with the current steering technology?
All of them have steering technology. So all of them have different types of leads, but all of them have forms of segmented leads, and we're able to use segments and steer the current. So all three companies have now, you know, segmented lead.
That's great. Do you have a rough idea of how many patients worldwide have had DBS implanted for PD and essential tremor?
I think I'm blanking if that slide that I showed, if that 160,000, and that was given to me by the Medtronic people, if that is just in this country or worldwide. But I can get that number if somebody needs to know.
It's an interesting question. One of the most impactful advances in the history of neurosurgery. Dr. Y asks, any adverse effect on dopaminergic agents on sperm in the fetus? Interesting.
That's an interesting question. I'm not aware of there being any teratogenic effects with levodopa, probably because it has not been studied in that population. And I'm not aware of any spermatogenesis effects with these medications.
So with that, I'm going through, that was the most interactive session we've ever had. So that was incredible. The number of great questions that have come through the pipeline. I'm reviewing to make sure we don't have any more. This talk again, because of that discussion that came out, we will definitely have this online for review later on. You go to the PNI website and look under education and courses, and you'll see the neuroscience grand rounds, and they will be uploaded to YouTube shortly. I'm going to give it a moment here to see if any other questions are coming up. That was really great. So with that, thank you all so much for joining us. Thank you, Dr. Diaz. That was phenomenal. And the advances seem to be coming so quickly, so you may not be able to hold me off for another 4 years here. No, it's great. We will definitely have an update coming up in the not too distant future. And if there's any other additional considerations or questions specific to this, that's wonderful. Dr. Walensky, thank you. We will please reach out, please email Dr. Diaz or myself, and we will get those other talks. We will see you again in March, second week in March again. And everybody have a happy and safe February. Happy Valentine's Day.